What's going on, everybody? Gareth here, FCP Euro. Welcome back to another video. Today we're going to be talking about the F33 series suspension setup, both X-Drive and non-X-Drive. Some of the things to be aware of, how to investigate certain types of suspension problems you might have, sort of explain the design and pretty much everything we need to really know in order to properly maintain one of these cars. But we're actually gonna put this car up in the air behind us. It happens to be an X-Drive car, but we can talk about a lot of the same things, whether X-Drive or not X-Drive. And we'll actually show you both the front suspension and rear suspension and the things to be aware of during the ownership period of one of these cars. So we have the car up in the air, and obviously this is an X-Drive vehicle because, well, it has a front axle. But there's a lot of things that are similar between the X-Drive and non-X-Drive chassis. So pretty much whether it's X-Drive or not X-Drive, it's gonna have two front control arms in this same layout. So it's going to have the curved larger arm up here that's called the thrust arm or tension strut, and then this lower control arm is always going to be in this position, and this is just the wishbone. Every single one of these front suspensions is this two link style setup. The thrust arm pretty much locates the entire front suspension, and this wishbone pretty much sets the track width. Usually what you're going to run into, at least on these control arms, unless you've had a curb strike and you've physically bent these control arms, there's really only two ways they fail. Either the bushing itself has worn out, which, you know, if you take a pry bar and you were to push on the arm from behind, if it was a really bad bushing, you would actually see the whole control arm move around. The other possibility is for the ball joint to wear. When the ball joint wears, you'll actually get play in the ball joint where you can actually see it move up and down. So if the wheel was still on the car, you'd physically be able to pull and see movement here in the ball joint. Now, these are newer control arms, so there's not going to be that situation there. But between the wishbone and the thrust arm is usually going to be the one that has the bushing failure. As you can see, it's a much larger bushing. And as the car is traveling down the road, the forces are wanting to pull the suspension back this way. And this thrust arm pretty much maintains geometry of the suspension. So this bushing sees quite a bit of load. And along with that, obviously you have the tie rod, but that's part of the car's steering system. This is another point to bring up, only because if you're suffering from excessive tire wear in the front, it's usually due to a bad alignment. Most people's initial instinct is to replace the control arms, but don't necessarily check the tie rod. If the tie rod has play, so the inner joint or the outer joint, you could take this to an alignment shop and have an alignment done on it, but that alignment is pretty much worthless, because if there is play within this tie rod, the wheel toe can change all the time. So this is another area to check. Usually, if it's the inner ball joint, if you grab the wheel at the 3 and 9 o'clock position and you moved it back and forth, you would actually be able to feel the play in here. If it's just the outer ball joint that's loose, it's normally horizontal play. Very rarely we get side-to-side play in this outer ball joint, but that would be very, very worn if that was the case. Another thing to note on these F30s, this is obviously, like I said earlier, the X-Drive car, but BMW sort of designed a front-end fuse for the suspension. What can happen is if you hit a pothole that's severe enough, it can cause the entire strut to be pushed down through the knuckle. And at that point, well, if it's an X-Drive car, you're probably gonna have to replace the axle. On any of these cars, you have to replace the knuckle, you have to replace the strut at that point. Basically, what they did is they've made the fuse here so that instead of it blowing out the shock tower, or the strut tower in this case, it'll just allow the strut to move down through the knuckle. So another thing to note as well, whether it's an X-Drive car or a non-X-Drive car, the front control arms are all aluminum. So it's a cast aluminum arm. This is the rear wheel drive variant of the thrust arm. You can see it's a slightly different shape, but it's still the same design. So all the front suspension components, 2 series, 3 series, 4 series, it's all gonna be aluminum in the front. The knuckle itself is aluminum, and all of the wheel bearings are bolt-on. The other thing to note, particularly at the top of the car, the top strut mount, BMW has two variations. They have a 5-bolt top and a 3-bolt top. Earlier production cars are a 3-bolt top, later production is a 5-bolt. In this particular vehicle's case, it's a 3-bolt, and also it has aftermarket coilovers on it, so this doesn't really matter, but for anybody who's replacing the front struts and putting new strut mounts on, the strut mounts do not come from BMW threaded. Traditionally, they use studs. However, BMW's now gone over to using bolts to locate the strut mount. those bolt holes are not threaded. The screws or the fasteners that are used are self-tapping and they make their own threads. So if you get a strut mount and you see that there's no threads cut in, that's totally normal. Now in the front suspension, the other variants that you need to think about as well, some of these cars have adaptive suspension, so it'll be electronic dampers. There's a whole bunch of different variations of front suspensions for both the struts and even the sway bars. But one thing to note about the sway bars is the sway bar bushings are actually bonded to the sway bar. So hypothetically, if you hear like a squeak every time you go over bump and it's the sway bar bushing, unfortunately you need to replace the entire sway bar. You can't just replace the bushing anymore because it's physically part of the sway bar. The only exception to that rule is PowerFlex does make some replacement bushings, but you would have to remove the bonded rubber and then put the polyurethane on there instead. So that is an option. Most are just gonna end up replacing the entire sway bar itself. And I would say the most common noise you'd ever hear from the front suspension on any BMW is the sway bar link. These sway bars, now this one is an aftermarket one because of the coilovers, but typically your factory sway bars, the ball joint is in a plastic cap. And what'll happen with those is they start to get loose over time, and every single time you go over a bump at low speed, you'll hear a click from the front suspension. Almost every single time, that is gonna be the sway bar link that's making that noise. It's not really a huge issue, it's more of an annoyance, but just a simple little click and you don't feel any feedback through the steering wheel, 9 times out of 10, it's gonna be the sway bar link that's making the noise. But that pretty much covers the front suspension. They're relatively the same, whether X-drive or non-X-drive, and the general layout is pretty much the same. Only exception, like I said, is the front axle being in position. So with that said, let's go ahead and move to the rear suspension, talk about what's going on there. So here we are at the rear suspension. Whether it's an X-drive car or a non-X-drive car, it's all gonna look the same. All the same parts, literally nothing different here. One thing to note is I mentioned in the front that everything is, you know, basically cast aluminum. Well, we move here to the rear and everything is basically stamped steel. So as you see, here's our tow arm, that's stamped steel. Our lower rollover, well, the BMW term is a rollover strut, but technically this is where your shock and spring sit, and this is also your camber adjustment. So your toe link, this is the toe adjustment and this is camber. But that's stamped steel, the upper arms are stamped steel. And then we have our semi-trailing arm right here, also stamped steel. So basically it's just a one piece of steel that's stamped in a die and then has the bushings pressed into it. It's not particularly anything fancy or high dollar. It's actually really, really cheap, which is kind of disappointing. They really started this with the E90, but if you looked at some of the E90 components, these are even smaller. So I'd say one of the most common things you're gonna run into on these control arms, particularly these smaller stamped steel arms, if you were to have a curb strike or maybe hit a pothole in a certain way, these can actually bend pretty easily, which is a good thing and a bad thing. Good thing in that it doesn't do damage to the subframe, it won't do damage to your differential. Bad in that bends pretty easily. Basically, the rear suspension is a 5-link setup, so there's 5 of these control arms in total. 2 of them are responsible for the alignment, so we already talked about that. This is your toe adjustment, this is your camber adjustment. You have 2 upper arms. You have a central upper arm, which is straight up. You have a forward arm, and then this is your semi-trailing arm right here. This is pretty much a carryover from, like I said, the previous generation 3 series, which would be the E90, very similar layout. So when we move out here to the wheel carrier, that's a cast steel piece, and your wheel bearings and wheel hub are actually pressed in. So it's not a bolt on like the front. Now moving here to the shock and the spring, it's a divorced setup. So the spring is inboard, shock is outboard. One thing I will say is BMW did get smart about this and they moved the shock mount. So the mounting hardware is actually underneath the car. So for the first time in 3 Series history, you don't need to disassemble half your trunk to get to the shock mounts, which is fantastic. Literally, you can do everything you need. If you're just replacing the shocks, it's 3 bolts at the top, a bolt and nut at the bottom, in and out, done. It's great. So that's an improvement there. And just for reference, here's what that upper shock mount looks like. It's a cast aluminum piece with a little rubber, almost like a foam style bushing in there, and a washer to hold everything in place. Similar to the front suspension, you know, this does have coilovers on it, but if it had factory dampers, there's electronic damping, there's sport suspension, there's standard suspension, there's multiple different shocks and even springs available for the rear suspension all that is pretty much determined by VIN or whatever the car was installed with in the factory. If you've gone to aftermarket stuff like this, that's kind of irrelevant. But again, when you're ordering the factory replacement parts, you do technically need to decode the VIN in order to get the information as to which suspension option your vehicle came with. Another thing to note, your sway bar. This is pretty much carried over from the E90 as well. The sway bar kind of swoops down and then it goes up over the top of the subframe. Now the sway bar is pretty dinky on these rear suspensions. The sway bar is very flexible. I can literally move it with my hand. But in order to replace the sway bar, again, if the bushing started making noise, you'd have to actually lower the whole rear subframe just to get to it and remove it. So hopefully that's never a problem. But also looking here at the rear suspension, the other element to this equation is you have your full subframe here. So the subframe is mounted to the bottom of the car with four subframe mounts. They're just rubber bushings. They are a wear item. We'll call it, let's say 100,000 miles is realistically where you'd start to look to replace them. But the thing with that is, with this rear suspension design, if those subframe mounts wear out, the subframe can shift around and move around a lot, which can cause some alignment problems. So these are often overlooked. They often never ever get replaced. And people literally just drive the car 200,000 miles, not knowing that their rear end is literally just sort of moving around all the time. So it's sort of a very overlooked, commonly overlooked thing, but that is something to be aware of. If we move to here, you'll start to notice things like this and things like that. On the F30, they started using a lot of vibration dampers for cutting down noise. It's a little bit of a strange thing to see. Really don't know the whole story behind this or what the engineering aspect of it was. I guess maybe there was some kind of unwanted noises or things that were going back into the passenger cabin. So they added these vibration dampers, and they're different depending on the car. They may be there, they may not be there. It's totally random. To also kind of go along with this, the differential, always going to be in the rear. X-Drive or not, they're rear-wheel drive-based cars. So you have your diff mounts. You have two of them here in the forward position, so you can actually see these dips on the subframe. And then you have another one actually right up here. So it's three diff mounts in total. Again, those are also another thing that are often overlooked. People go an entire lifetime on the car, never replace them. And literally the diff can be moving around quite a bit without you knowing it. And you could also potentially, depending on how worn those diff mounts are, you'll get a lot of vibrations and things going back into the passenger cabin or clunkiness in the drivetrain. So that's another thing to potentially be aware of. I'd say 100,000 miles, you'd probably be looking at those. At the same time, you'd be looking at the subframe mounts. Another thing that's unique to the F30, and something that's absolutely not a carryover, they added this aerodynamic element here. So as the air is traveling through, instead of getting pulled up into this area up here, it's just pushed down and underneath the car. Kind of an interesting thing. The only issue that I see with this is, seeing as this stamped steel arm probably collects a lot of debris, sand, moisture, this would probably trap even more and potentially rot out this lower control arm. So it probably won't hurt. Every year, every couple of years, drop this down, clean it all out, make sure this arm is clean. There's nothing sitting in there, because I would imagine if enough debris were to get stuck in there, it would start rotting it from the inside out. Another kind of unique thing about these rear suspensions is you'll notice these style bolts right here with this little triangular washer. In a perfect world, you would never have a bushing bolted to another suspension element like this. So inboard here, where you have the bushing between two pieces of the subframe, if the control arm were to ever slip off the bushing, it can't go anywhere. In this particular situation, if the control arm started sliding off the bushing, if this washer wasn't here, this arm could potentially just fall off the car. The bushing would stay in place, but you know, this is more or less a safety washer. You would say that this arm is in a single shear situation, and so this is to prevent that arm from possibly sliding off the bushing and causing an even bigger problem. This is something that got carried over from the E93 series. There's actually three of these bolts in total on each side. The upper arm and this upper forward arm both use that style bolt. A lot of these fasteners are one-time use only. So these control arms recently got replaced in a DIY video that we did. All these bolts are torqued to yield. They need to be replaced when you replace the control arms themselves, or if they're simply being removed for other work, you gotta replace those bolts. And the only thing that we did not know until we did the DIY video, it's one thing you absolutely need to know about these rear suspensions. This upper center control arm, the bolt that holds the bushing inboard up there, absolutely impossible to get to unless you buy an offset wrench, 18 mil, and cut it in half. If you want to remove that upper arm, you need to make a tool because the shape of the subframe, the location of the spring, basically everything, there's just no room to get to it. So You almost don't need any special tools to work on the rear suspension. It's just that one bolt you need to do something for. If you've worked on a BMW before, any modern BMW, you would see these multi-link rear suspensions. If you're coming from an older BMW, let's say like an E36 or an E46, a lot of this might look foreign to you, but these newer multi-link rear suspensions are really good for just maintaining suspension geometry through suspension travel, which is why they went to this style design. Basically, as the suspension moves up and down, you don't get any unwanted toe or camber changes, and this is why you see five control arms all being used with different angles and stuff. So it looks a little bit sophisticated at first when you look at it, but there really isn't too much that can happen to the rear suspension here that would mess up the alignment. Yeah, so that pretty much covers everything you really need to know about the rear suspension on these cars. You know, since we've talked about the front and the rear suspension, and this video is all about F30 suspension, let's go head back to the bench and wrap it up. Anyway, we hope you learned a lot about the suspension setup on these F30 chassis cars. Of course, this is going to apply to the F22, F23 2 series, as well as the F32, F33, and F36 4 series, since it is a shared platform. A lot of what we went over is going to cover really any of those cars, whether X-Drive or rear-wheel drive, it's pretty much all the same setup. So with that said, if you have any questions or comments, leave in the comment box below. If you have your own story or experience, go ahead and leave that for us as well. We'd love to see it. Go ahead and hit that like button if you like these videos, and also subscribe. We have a lot more videos on the way. And as always, we'll see you for the next one. Thanks for watching.